morning, everyone. I will continue my last talk about modeling. Now we go to the modeling of vector-borne disease. So my talk is will be divided into some subsection. That is vector-borne disease. What is vector-borne disease leading to mosquito-borne disease? Then a simple case using our one of our district data in West Java, then continue to climate model on vector-borne disease. And we also use a study case in Semarang as a capital city of Central Java. Then we go to the dengue, the serotype, transmission among population modeling. And I will end with the coexistence of modeling dengue COVID using our 27 district or cities in Java. So let's get start. Vector-borne disease. What is vector-borne disease? This kind of disease that need a vector. Vector in the terminology of epidemiology, not a vector column or row vector in our mathematical terms, but a kind of small animals that can transmit the pathogen, can be virus, bacteria, or Plasmodium vivax, what is, yeah, kind of malaria transmission. So I will pinpoint to the mosquito-borne disease. So there are two types of vector-borne disease, that is anthropognathic infections and also zoonotic infection. This anthropognathic infection theoretically can be eradicated from the population when infection humans can be treated well in the hospitals. But we know malaria, dengue, yellow fever, Zika, and etc. should be seasonal in most Asian region. So different with airborne disease like COVID. For dengue or malaria or yellow fever needs some small animal to transmit the disease from humans to humans. So this is the components of vector-borne disease. We have host like human or other big animal, then vector, of course, we should know the biological behavior of the vector, then the transmission cycle between host and the vector, then also pathogen, that like I said, virus, bacteria, and also some other small microscopical things. Then the most important thing, because we consider the vector, of course, ecological factor, for example, like climate information, will be placed an important role in the biological behavior of the vector. So I cite from Raisin 2010. And also we have three crucial of vector-borne disease, that is susceptible population, then vector, and also pathogen. We have virus, once again, virus, the survival rate of the virus, the virulence of the virus, replication in host, I mean virulence in how the virus will be produced itself in our host, for example, blood or whatever, and the rate of transmission. Then the vector, survival rate of this vector, lifespan, and reproduction, breeding patterns, biting behavior is, of course, affected by ecological factor. So we have three kind of the crucial elements. Then we know from the report from WHO, neglected tropical disease, the high risk situation will be held by the poverty region. So we have dengue. The pathogen is virus, it called serotype. We have one up to four flavivirus serotype that already established, but some of the observation say that it could be more than four serotypes. Then the factor indoor, it should be Aedes aegypti mosquito, but we also found some albopictus, Aedes albopictus, in outdoor region, specifically in our country. Then this is anthropognathic transmission. So yellow fever and Zika and also, what is it? Malaria is also anthropognathic transmission. Then this one, West Nile, Lyme, and encephalitis, we also still found in some village in our province. So we have a, what is it, a big feet, like elephant feet, we call it in our village. Yeah. Then the activity of the factors and also survival rate of the factor is affected by the humidity, relative humidity, heavy rainfall or precipitation. If the factor is very active, increasing activity of the factor will be increase the rates of transmission, that it will be dangerous. Then also the factor survival. Basically, for example, mosquito can be survive 2 weeks, 14 days, 2 weeks, but in laboratory they can be survive up to 2 months. And then in our entomological laboratory, they can maintain the egg of Aedes up to 1 year. So yeah, that's possible. And also for factor survival, temperature also play an important role. Then also mortality rates and then life cycle length, yeah, fecundity and etc. So this is the simple case. The data collection helped by the Department of Health in Cirebon District, one of the in West Java province. This is Cirebon District. Then we have this observation area. So this area cover this place. They collect from October 15, 2011 up to March 5, 2012. And this is a big challenge for us to observe the data. They put some mosquito traps on that area. Then once over 3 days, they report to us they're collecting egg and also larva, a flick of the mosquito. But unfortunately, not all of the area finish this duty, because at the end of the period, they have a big fleet. So breeding site of the mosquito will be disappear at that time. So this is the data. We should use manual using Excel. We collecting once over 3 days. And this is the density map of the population come from the data. This is egg population for the observation data. And this is the larva population or the flick population. Then also we use discrete modeling for each day life cycle of mosquito. Then we have 22 compartment for difference equation to see the aquatic phase, that is initiate egg and larva. Then for mosquito phase, nulliparous and also parous. We have these two for mosquito and W1, W2, and L for aquatic phase. Then the solution is very easy because it's just a difference equation at the limited time. So we use a projection population matrix. These two is fecundity and also survival rate and transition rate between each step. So we have initial population for each stage, initiate egg, larva, nulliparous, and pharaohs. Then we also calculate the basic reproduction number to see the abundance of the mosquito based on all the parameters. But unfortunately, I don't write the specific what is. This is a kind of desperate. A, B, C, A, D, E, F, G, H, A, B, C, D, into K, because we lost, you know, we have many parameters here. And this is very not nice to see. So we just plug A until K. This is not good for a mathematical point of view, yeah. But yeah, okay. So we have this kind of basic reproduction ratio. Then we plot for only for simulation to prove that if R not equal to 1, then population will be stay constant for every egg, this larva, sorry, this egg, this mosquito, and the green one is for green one for mosquito, sorry, red one is for egg, then the black one is for larva. Sorry, it's still in Indonesia. I have no time to rerun again in using English. And what about R not greater than one? We have a epidemic situation for the abundance of the population. For example, this is the red one for egg. It will be growing up, and also for larva in the black one, and the green one is for mosquito population. Then, as I said in the previous, that not all of the area have a good data. We only simulate these two, these three region. So all of the region have R not below one. Yeah, so we can conclude that it will be safe. But yeah, you know, collecting data is a very big challenge. A good data will be give a good information, but I'm afraid it will be misleading because yeah, okay, we are safe here, so we don't need to do anything. Yeah. So this is our big challenge before pandemic. Before, it is very hard to get the data. They don't believe us as a mathematician. They just say, okay, you can work with your model, you can say anything, then we don't do nothing. So this is our steady case before pandemic, but now we have a better relationship with Department of Health. So they are eager to have to give us support to better data. So I hope it will be continuous. Now we move to the climate models on vector-borne disease. We move to the Semarang city. This is the capital of Central Java. This work already published in Asian Pacific Journal of Tropical Disease in 2017, collaboration with work with Pramastia Putra. This is Semarang. I think I have the same problem with Mark. So this is Semarang. You can see how dense population here. This is a very urban. And then we compare to area. This is Indonesia, and we have this Java Island, Sumatra, in the center of Java, the capital city of Central Java. And you can see this is a very similar type of Java capital city, very dense population. Then we compare two area, the highland and also the lowland. Semarang is lowland, very urban, dense population. Then they have a annual seasonal spike for dengue cases. So this is okay. Slower lah. Ah, okay. The yellow one is the urban area. So almost all the area are full with the houses. Yeah. So if we have abundance of the factors in some area here, so it will be outbreaks of dengue fever. Then this is the, okay, we wait. Okay. Okay. But I still in Zoom? Ah, okay. Yeah. This is the data. The precipitation, the average temperature, average humidity, number of rainy days, and the HF incidence. You know the wiggle one, the blue one. Oh, okay. 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 The blue one is for okay. Okay. The blue one is for the HF incidence, and the red one is for the precipitation or rainfall. And the last three, this is the average of temperature, humidity, and also number of rainy days. You can see in this data, we start this one. This is the precipitation, the red one, and this is the peak of the dengue incidence. You know, not every peak, but you can see with your naked eyes, we can see this spike correlated with this spike. When we low, correlated with the one, the red one behind, then we have this one with this one, this one with this one, etc. This one with this one. At least we have some kind of assumption that perhaps there is connection between precipitation and also the incidence of dengue. So we use a simple correlation in statistical approach to see the correlation. But unfortunately, because of very wiggle data, we have only humidity, but it is not reach 50. 0.5, only 0.46, etc. But the others with the with dengue incidence only below 50%. But based on some difference, the humidity have a very related with dengue incident. So yeah, we accept this correlation. This is correlation between any two climate data, so obviously it should be higher in precipitation and humidity, and also humidity and the number of rainy days, because the calculation for humidity comes from the two parameters. Then the objective study is to model the relationship between climate parameter and the HF incidence, but through the mosquito population. So the red one, I skip the red one first. Then to model the dynamic of mosquito population, including larva and egg, and also their behavior depend on the climate information. Why? Because if we want to develop an early warning systems, if we follow the incidents, normally can be too late to have an alert. So we try to derive the early warning system from dynamic of mosquito. And this is so many argue, because how you can count the mosquito population? We embed the dynamic of mosquito using climate information, because the tools in climate predictions are already established. So hopefully we can use the nice prediction to predict the mosquito behavior. But it's just still our dreams. We already have an early warning system based on dengue incidents, but not yet in mosquito dynamics. Next step. So the method, we perform the statistical analysis, we use standard the host factor SIR model, and then yeah, we just performing a simple sensitivity analysis among the parameters to see influenced by climate factors. Then we do multicollinear tests to see the tolerance value and also variance inflation factors, because we need to choose which one of the set of the data that be involved in our model. So all of our set of parameters include to be involved in the model. And this is modeling mosquito dynamics. And will be extended by Kamal for evening talk. We have this cycle from egg to adult mosquito. So from egg, larva, pupa, juvenile, and adult mosquito. We only divide into two stage, larva stage and adult mosquito stage. Why? Because we want to incorporate the result into our dynamical system. So we have information for the climate depend on the time. So this is a non-autonomous system. So we include some survival rate for mosquito, survival rate for larva depend on temperatures. And then we use some kind of logistic equation to capture the breeding site and also the behavior of the larva and also pupa, yeah, and also the adult mosquito based on the climate factors. See that the data already have so many peak. So this is the solution of previous equation. We have mosquito in the red one. The precipitation or rainfall is the black one. The monthly incidence is the magenta one. This is the incidence. And larva in the blue one. So we want to see the difference between time lag between the rainfall, because we want to see the climate factor, and the mosquito population. So you see the similar things. We have some peak in the precipitation or rainfall accumulation with the abundance of mosquito. So once again, we do some correlation with this result and test which one is have the highest correlation. And one important thing, this is in days, but our colleague from climate agency wants us to give a monthly incident and also weekly incidents. They want to compare this, those two information about the model, because in the view of health department, they need for them it's easy to see weekly, because they should execute foaming, fogging, or some kind of preventive action for mosquito behavior in week, not in month. But unfortunately, we have a good result in month, still in month. So this is the correlation between rainfall and the density of larva mosquito. So you can ignore the density of larva and mosquito because of absolutely high. But this is correlation for 2 months periods with the 2 months previous. This is 1 month, and this is 3 months. And yeah, we have rainfall on mosquito density around 70%, but the highest is in the 2 months previous, 72%, rather than 3 months or 1 month. Yeah, so we choose 2 months previous, and we confirm with some data from different city, also have the same conclusion. This is correlation if we downgrade to the weeks period. So you can see below 50% if we downgrade to the 8 weeks previous. So we rather choose the monthly correlation. Then this is our important finding in some data, that 2 months previous is for peak of the precipitation compared to the peak of the mosquito behavior, or the lowest precipitation have strong correlation with the lowest mosquito density on that period. Then this more or less have 2 months correlation. So with this one, we sent the health department to do early warning in the sense of preventing the abundance of mosquito. And this is also the data from 2004 up to 2012. Why is very old? Because yeah, we have this project in 2012 up to 2014. Then after that, we can contact them again to have the incidence of dengue data. So it's hard if we don't have a good connection. And we try to compare two climate station in city, that is Semarang station and also Ungaran station. Semarang is in lowland, so we have a similar situation, but I will show you in a table. This is for Ungaran weather station data. So if we see, if we compare in the table, we can see clearly that for highland rather than lowland, we have the mean of mosquito density highest in the lowland. So you can see the mosquito density and larva density is highest in the lowland rather than highland. Also, it's only not really big difference here. So in this study, we found that perhaps the hot climate produce more density of squid, yeah. Like in this area, I don't know. I often found so many mosquito in the room rather than in my house. I live in Bandung, Highland, so normally I rare to find mosquito. Thanks God. But yeah, in this area I found. But fortunately, when I kill mosquito, there are no blood. So if you kill the mosquito, then you have a blood. It will be a female mosquito, the transmit of the dengue. But if you kill the mosquito, just left the body, the black body, that is probably a male mosquito, yeah? Or, yeah. We use some repellent or something. Yeah. So we have this kind of remark for including climate factor into the vector borne disease modeling, that is mosquito Aedes aegypti density. And we move to the key. I cite from the trends of microbiology. Okay, dengue is viral infection, of course, transmitted to humans through the bite of infected mosquito, and then causing by some virus called Denvi. So we have Denvi 1 up to Denvi 4. This is a challenge to produce the vaccination for dengue, because polyvalent vaccine, one vaccine that mean to all of the serotype of dengue, is very hard to do. I think already 30, 40 years and still didn't make it. And for dengue vaccine, we have a warning immunity. So it could be dangerous if the dengue vaccine administered to children under 9 years old. Some study proved that result. So, yeah, vaccination in dengue is still challenging. So we have this one, health map for dengue. I browsed this last week. So in our country, Filipina and also Indonesia, we have some red spot. It means that something happened about dengue in this area. I think it's already updated, and I hope all blind spot, all red spot will be disappear. But based on the trends on microbiology, this is the special pattern of the dengue virus 1. From the beginning, 1948, up to 2013, we see cover of our nation. Is that true? Yeah. This one, yeah? Filipina in this one. This is Malaysia. Dengue rare to found in our island of Kalimantan. But you can see Java Island, most of them are red because very dense and urban population. This is for dengue virus 1. Fortunately, still happen for dengue virus 2. We have this one. And dengue virus 3 also remain the same. And also work for dengue virus 4. So our nation circulate by all dengue virus serotype. So it should be here, because the secondary infection could be more severe than first infection. And this is the global spread of dengue virus types, mapping the 70 years history according to the trends of microbiology. Then we have experienced all of the dengue serotype. So yeah, this is basically our national problem, seasonal problem. But we try our best to give some kind of scientific backup and information to our government and health department. So this is the dengue modeling among population with vaccination strategy. We have this diagram. So as I said in the previous, the secondary infection, the third infection, or the fourth infection is more dangerous than the first infection. So at first, we have a susceptible population here by the infected mosquito. Then we experience the first infection. Normally, this is only get the dengue fever. So after some times, just get a light flu, for example, a headache, then recover the Z1. Then biting by the mosquito with the different serotype with this V1. So for example, in the first bite, we get the serotype 1, and the second bite, we get serotype 4, or serotype 3, or serotype 2. Then we will go to hospital, the severe experience for a secondary infection. But some people also survive. But in hospital, normally we found the secondary infection for dengue fever. So more severe than first infection. So this is the diagram for the situation. We have a susceptibility index, sigma 2. And also we have Q portion for hospitalization. As I said in the previous, the vector-borne disease caused by mosquito should be eradicated when the infection people treated in the hospital. But unfortunately, it is not easy because in Indonesia, we have a very big population. So that's yeah, kind of impossible thing to do simultaneously. Yeah. And this is the model, the standard of susceptible infection recovery model. But we have index here. I just follow the two index, for example, the two different type of serotype, and already published in Bulletin of Malaysian Mathematical Society in 2007, very old, yeah. And we try to develop this kind of model with vaccination strategy. So we propose four different vaccination strategy, very trivial one. The scenario one, we assume tetravalent vaccine or polyvalent, one vaccine mean for every serotype, still impossible. And bivalent vaccine, bivalent, I don't know. I don't know, but dengue vaccine only mean for one serotype, yeah. Bivalent vaccine mean for two different serotype. We call it a scenario three. We administer this kind of vaccine to the newborn baby. The second one, we administer randomly to the susceptible host, not newborn, with the same with the same assumption. We use tetravalent vaccine and also bivalent vaccine. Then we have by your sense, this is bivalent, this is tetravalent, should be good enough in scenario one and scenario two, right? Because this mean mean for all serotype of dengue virus. So this is the result. Not nice because this is old. There is no credible interval. There is no prediction interval. Just solution based on some data. to show that the vaccination will be reduced the infected. This is unvaccinated result. This is result for first vaccination. So the cases decrease. We normalize the model, so the maximum should be one. And then this is first infection, this is secondary infection, and this is severe dengue infection. And the vaccination two and also other vaccination is, like I said before, the tetravalent vaccine is very good result in our computation. So this is only a simulation, not based on the real data in 2007. Then we have a co-infection situation. So in the pandemic era, so many dengue patients that would not come to the hospital because they are afraid to judge by the RT-PCR and etc. So in West Java, we have the highest number of the dengue in the 2020, and my city Bandung is the highest incidence dengue, first rank in Indonesia. Unfortunately, that's something that we can frown off. So this is the, I think I skipped this one, it's very trivial. Then for dengue, this one. So some news say that the death rate due to dengue fever in West Java, in my province, is the second highest nationally after some area in the East. Is Indonesia. And Bandung City is one of the highest causes of death in West Java and also in Indonesia should be, yeah. So this is a very dangerous situation because it comes up with COVID. So we propose this model, the co-infection of COVID-19 and dengue. What is co-infection? This is the simultaneously infection a single host with several pathogens. So the COVID virus meet the dengue virus. And it will be dangerous if they are collaborate like us. Yeah, so they are collaborate to make something in our DNA and then produce some variants, new variants or no. I don't hope that will be happen. But in the real situation, co-infection of COVID-19 and dengue is happen in some area in the world. So yeah, as I said before, high number of positive cases of COVID-19 during the pandemic. The dengue cases decrease so slowly because underreported patients, not because it's all already eradicated, but I mean unreported cases. So this is some area from we read from reference that existing co-infection between COVID and dengue. Oh, I forgot to say this is part of master thesis by Andy. I supervise him with my colleague in system biology. So we have the real situation. We try to capture the situation with model, and we use West Java data to validate. But unfortunately, it is easy to say but not to do. Yeah. Then we have this one. We try to modeling the co-infection between COVID-19 and dengue phenomena. We try to find the equilibrium and also the stability. Then we want to simulate based on the real data in our district and city, 27, but I also use some of them, not all of the result. then we deal with these variables. You know, as usual, these susceptible people, I1 note by COVID virus, I2 refer to dengue virus, I12 co-infection between COVID and dengue, and M0 is for susceptible mosquito, and M1 is for infected mosquito by dengue virus. And we assume it's only one serotype play the role. So if you want all the serotypes involved, you just simply add some index on the equation. So this is the set of parameters that we use. Natural birth rate of human. This is, survival rate of mosquito. We can count factually natural birth and death rate of mosquito, but just simply substitute with survival rate of mosquito. This is the contact rate with human who infected by COVID-19 serotype, biting rate of the infected mosquito to human, recovery rate, and then, the complex things that we have so many situations. So I enter all of the picture here. We have this possibility. So the green one refer to susceptible people. Blue one is for COVID. Red one is for dengue. Black one is the worst case, the co-infection between COVID and dengue. You have all the possible situation. For example, from susceptible, it can be get the COVID, that then he can deliver the new cases of COVID, because COVID human to human. The second one, we have susceptible, then contact with COVID dengue, but if we contact with susceptible people, COVID, it be COVID. And also the experience of both of dengue COVID, birth new dengue COVID. Then we have susceptible people. Unfortunately, dengue is a vector-borne disease. So when you meet the mosquito, the infected mosquito, then you will get experience with dengue. So and also the infected mosquito. So susceptible, infected mosquito will be produce dengue and also other infected mosquito. Susceptible mosquito bite the dengue patient will be become an infected mosquito, yeah. Then COVID biting by dengue mosquito, why? Infected mosquito then produce the COVID dengue mosquito and also other infected mosquito, yeah, etc. You can see. And we have direct transmission and also indirect transmission. Indirect transmission means we need a mosquito to transmit the disease, but direct transmission, we just human to human, because we also involve the COVID human to human transmission. So susceptible mosquito, the green one, will also be an infected mosquito when it bites the dengue patient or it bites the COVID dengue patient. So how complex this situation? So try to develop one by one. Then we have this diagram. Yeah, like this. The line, the bold line is direct transmission. The dashed line is indirect transmission. And we involve off of the mosquito and host. Then, as usual, compartmental model, we have this equation. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We have 6 system of ordinary differential equation, non-linear, but it's trivial. So the interesting thing that we just get two kind of basic reproduction ratio, only for COVID and dengue, not both of them. If you want to put both of them, you should change this equation. Yeah, we choose the easy, the simple one things first at first. So we have the equilibrium setting the right hand side as zero. We have I skip this one. In the domain of positivity set here, invariant solution, we have the equilibrium points. For equilibrium points, we have this equilibrium, all of points are zero. We have COVID equilibrium, and we have dengue equilibrium. When we reach COVID equilibrium, only infected COVID are non-zero. Then if we deal with the dengue equilibrium, only infected dengue equilibrium and the infected mosquito equilibrium, then we have E12 as a co-infection equilibrium. So all of the part of our coordinates are non-zero. So we have three kind of equilibrium points in the sense of dynamical system. So quite happy because we can write this equilibrium. Normally, if we deal with more than three equations, it is not easy to find the equilibrium. Then, but not easy to find the stability. So I skip the stability in this slide. Yeah, and this is the equilibrium points of coexistence. And using next generation operator, we develop the basic reproduction ratio, and from this matrix we get this one. We only have positive radius spectral of this matrix R01 and R02. R01 refer to the COVID and R02 refer to the dengue. But we didn't have the existence of both of the coexistence between dengue and COVID. Yeah. So we already have equilibrium system, but it is easy to ask if we can substitute all of the parameters in the terms of R0. So we have the diagram in the parameter space of R01 and R02 to see the stability of the equilibrium. So we have this one, the equilibrium points in the sense of R01 and R02, and you see that this is free, always exists for every parameters of R01 and R02, and I1 for COVID will be exist only if R01 greater than 1. Otherwise, we have dengue endemic exist when R02 greater than 1. Then, if both if this condition fulfill, we have the coexistence equilibrium. So, from this instance, we have a good result, I think. And this is the local stability of equilibrium points. So trivial, yeah. We have if both of R0 less than 1, then should be this is free, locally asymptotically stable in our set of invariant solution. And yeah, you can read the rest. Then this is our result in parameter space of those basic reproductive number, have X horizon as X R1, R0 1, and Y horizon is R0 2. We have this separate area. Sorry, it should be E. So this is stability area for this is free equilibrium, and this one bounded by the green line, it should be the area of stability of equilibrium, and the blue area up there, this is stability area for the COVID equilibrium. Then the coexistence of these two diseases comes up in this blue, between blue and a green area. This is the stability area of the E12. So I think, yes, this is a nice result. We can do our simulation based on where we want to stable equilibrium, which if you want to D2, you can set your parameters here and etc. You will see the stability result of this model. Yeah, and we also have real data. So numerical simulation, we will estimate the real data of COVID and dengue in some area West Java. We use root mean square error. We just use least square to found the best fit, and is using two approach: weekly data and also monthly data. The same tools. Yeah, this is for West Bandung district agency, and this is for Bandung district. So you can see that in the 2020, COVID are already high cases, yeah, rather than dengue. So normally, all of our simulation, the R naught always the R naught for dengue always below the R naught of COVID. That's normal because we use this kind of data. So this is the result for Bandung district and West Bandung district. So for this estimate process, divide our X horizon into three time step. You can see if we only do one step to estimate all the parameters, it will be lost. For example, if we just do one step, this will following this line and up. We need to go there. So what we can do, we cut this data until this. So this one period, second period, and the third period. We see the trend of the data and we estimate each of parameters. So we don't do the estimation in one step, but we divide in the X horizon. And also for the red one, the COVID, we also do the same things. So this is a lot of work in terms of numerical simulation to estimate the parameters. And okay, you can also see the R naught. This is the only one. Then in the period three, the dengue is greater than COVID. Almost all simulation, the COVID should be greater than dengue. But in this one, we have dengue greater than COVID, only this one. Yeah? And we have Cimahi and also Bogor near Jakarta. We also have the similar result COVID already bigger, the R0, and also Bekasi and also Bogor. We have Bekasi City and Bekasi District. We also have Bogor, Bogor City and Bogor District. Forgot. Yeah, ini Bekasi City, Depok, around Jakarta. The satellite city around Jakarta, Bogor, Bekasi, Depok. And we also calculate the accumulation of West Java province. You can see here for these three period of time, COVID always bigger than dengue. But actually, the number of the dead patient is highest in Indonesia for dengue. Yeah. And we also do for monthly data approach, and we have the same, the similar result. But in the first period, we have some kind of existence of coexistence of dengue COVID. So in this period, in Bandung Barat, in West Bandung District, we have R0.1 and R0.2 bigger than 1. And also in Bandung District, we have R0.1 and R0.2 bigger than 1. It possible existence for, in the of sick reproduction ratio. Then we have Sumedang. You see Sumedang data. In the two period of R0 are greater than 1. So this is the probably danger situation in the graph, but not in the real time, I think. Kamal comes from Sumedang, so you can ask him. And also we have Bandung City, like that. And Cimahi, Bogor, we have the similar calculation when we go to the weekly approach, yeah? So, and in Java province, we have R0.1 always greater than R0.2 because you can see in the 2020, yeah, normal that COVID are very high numbers of incident. So this real data in our province. And what about coefficient? We just found one area that probably have co-infection in Bandung District. This is nearly 1. So, yeah, based on the hospital data, there are 1 or 2 patients experience both of the serotype, both of the virus, dengue and also COVID. So in our calculation with the this kind of data, we also almost find the dengue will be more than 1. So we have some kind of simulation, this only simulation, when both of the are not greater than 1, then we have endemic situation both for COVID and dengue. Yeah. Yeah. So that's our case study of co-infection case using West Java province. Yeah, I think that's all. Is that 1 hour? Okay. So just my conclusion that we can use a simple model using ordinary differential equation to make coexistence between COVID and dengue. Then we can explore the parameters, and you can change the model to found something specific, for example, a treatment, control for mosquito, repellent, using repellent, forming, fogging. You can put parameters of control of the differential equation system. Yeah, and I think this is the reference. And next, in the Friday morning, we will more on dengue model with some spatial and also related with the developing early warning system using climate factors, and that early warning system already by Jakarta province until now. We introduced those early warning since before pandemic 2019, and they still use until now. Very simple, but from the stakeholder point of view, it will help them to make some control strategies. And I will have full morning lecture in the dengue and the next Friday. So thank you very much for your listening.